Connie asked if everyone could hear. In 1990, I spoke at Urbana Missions Conference, and the sound system was a little bit iffy. So the moderator came up before I talked, and he said, "Can everyone hear the speaker?" The back auditorium, a hand raised up. It's a smart aleck guy that I knew, and he said, "I can hear the speaker, but I'd be happy to trade places with anyone who can't." I know you all know Murphy's Law. Anything that can go wrong will go wrong, right? You know there's a lot of corollaries to Murphy's Law. For example, if there is a possibility of several things going wrong, the one that will cause the most damage will be the one to go wrong. If there is a worst time for something to go wrong, it will happen then. If anything absolutely, positively, simply cannot go wrong, it will anyway. If you perceive that there are four possible ways in which a procedure can go wrong and circumvent these, then a fifth way, unprepared for, will promptly develop. How about this one? If you drop something on your driveway, it will roll underneath the car to the exact center. The chance of the bread falling with the buttered side down is directly proportional to the cost of the carpet. Here's the 50-50-90 rule. Anytime you have a 50-50 chance of getting something right, there's a 90% probability you'll get it wrong. If everything seems to be going well, you have obviously overlooked something. Give a man a fish, and he will eat for a day. Teach a man to fish, and he will sit in a boat all day drinking beer. You know why we laugh at those Murphy's Law things? Because there's so much truth in every one of them. And that's what we're going to see today. Murphy's Law out on the sea. We're wrapping up the book of Acts. We're looking at Paul's journey to Rome to visit with the Emperor Nero face to face. He expected to be cleared of all the charges the Jews had brought against him, and indeed he will be cleared. This ship voyage, as I said last week, it's a masterpiece of Greek literature. Unbelievers such as William Ramsay said, "It's the finest description of a sea voyage in ancient literature." It is a masterpiece. We have to understand it's an allegory. It's a biblical allegory. A biblical allegory is a story in which the elements in the physical realm correspond to realities in the spiritual realm. In the Bible, the sea is a picture of the world. And now we know the world is fallen. Therefore, in the Bible, the sea is a picture of the fallen world and that it's evil. It's dangerous. It's full of threats. And there are winds in the story. In the Bible, the winds are a picture of circumstances. And since the world has fallen, whenever we encounter winds in the Bible, it's adverse circumstances. It was winds that caused the famine that Joseph got the vision of, that scorched the grain and ruined the crops. It was the wind in Exodus that brought the locusts. It was the wind that destroyed Job. Winds are adverse circumstances. And what about boats? Boats are a picture of human life. Now, in Acts 27, in the boat, we have two groups of people. We have Paul, Luke, and Aristarchus, their friend from Thessalonica. Those are all believers. They have all trusted in Jesus as their Savior at one point in their lives. So we have three believers and approximately 264 unbelievers on the boat. And that is probably a pretty accurate picture of our life, accompanied by a few believers, but mostly unbelievers. So Acts 27, if you want to summarize it, the picture is this. It's a picture of our lives as believers, as we navigate through the adversities of a fallen world, accompanied by unbelievers and other believers. So they head out to Rome, and they're led by a centurion that was a Roman soldier, over 100 troops. His name was Julius. And they leave, very important, they set out from Caesarea in the middle of August in the year 60 AD. Now they have a substantial problem. They need to go west to Rome. Unfortunately, the prevailing winds were strongly from the west to the east. And I'll pause here and say that's a picture of the world right there. Whatever we want to do in the world, there's going to be adverse circumstances. That's the general course of the world. And in the Mediterranean, year-round, the winds blew from the west to the east. It's just a matter of their intensity. So obviously, they can't just head west. So they did what was typical then. They went north along the coast, up from Caesarea. They're hugging the coast. They're taking advantage of two things. There's always a gentle land breeze coming off, and sailors tack against that. And secondly, the current of the Nile was so strong, it actually flowed up into the Mediterranean and gave them a moderately north flow. About the time they passed Sidon, Lebanon on their right, on their east, the Nile current would run out. But about that time, they reached the cover of Cyprus. The large island of Cyprus gives them protection, so they tack along the coast there under the protection of Cyprus. But now they have to turn west. So they turn west, they sail under the coast of Asia, places like Cilicia, Pamphylia. Now, they're going very slowly, and time is an issue. Let me tell you again why time is an issue. Again, they left in the middle of the month of August of the year 60. From mid-September through mid-November, that was called the dangerous season for shipping. Think about that, middle of September to the middle of November. When you reach the middle of October, right in the middle of that season, that was called the treacherous season. So you had 3 months of danger. Within that, you had 6 weeks that it's treacherous to travel because of those winds. From mid-November to mid-February, all the harbors were closed. No shipping was permitted. So now we have it starting to have a time issue. Now Julius is thinking, we're in a time crunch, and the problem is we have this little small boat. Small boats have to keep tacking, have to keep hugging the coast. So when they get to the port of Myra, Julius gets a larger ship, and that's one that held 276 people. And his thinking was, well, we won't have to keep tacking along the coast. We can get out in open water. Well, they tried getting out in open water, and what did they meet? The winds coming from the west. So big boat, large boat, didn't matter. So they still go along hugging the coast until they get to Canidas. Now, Canidas is on the extreme southwest corner of what they call Asia, we call Turkey. Well, now they don't have the option of hugging the coast anymore because the coast ran out. I mean, they could go up north through the Aegean Sea, but that would waste a lot of time. So now they have to go out in the open sea, but they certainly can't go west because the wind now getting stronger and stronger from the west. So what do? They drop down to the south. They drop down to the south to take advantage of the island of Crete. So they sail underneath the island of Crete, again, hugging the coast as the winds get stronger and stronger. Finally, they arrive at a port called Fair Havens, and they stop there. Now, the centurion and the crew are thinking, let's keep going. And Paul, by the way, Paul, at this time in his life, we don't know when it happened, but he refers to the fact that prior to this, he'd already been involved in 3 shipwrecks. So Paul knew it was dangerous. And Paul points something out to them. He says, the Day of Atonement has passed. The Day of Atonement in the year 60 AD was October 6th. So now let's assume that now we're in the middle of October. What season is that? That's the treacherous season, especially if you're heading west. So Paul says, let's stay here for the winter. The sailors did not want to stay at Fairhaven because it was like podunk town. And they thought, If we can just go a little bit further west to Phoenix, that's where the action is. It's not too far. I know it's to the west, but if we tack along the coast, taking it easy, we can probably make it there. And so they do. And at first, it seemed like a good idea because, amazingly, a small wind picked up from the south. Very unusual. At any time in the Mediterranean, especially in the middle of October. And as I said last week, isn't this a picture of the way of the world? Give it your best shot. Try your best. Play the odds. And remember a blessing that the believer has that the unbeliever does not have about how to know God's will. It involves doing what is
obvious.
That's right. And remember, that blessing is something we can't overstate for a believer. I think we tend to take it for granted. But God has arranged things in our lives so that what we perceive as being the right thing to do is, in fact, the right thing to do. The path of the righteous is a highway because He's cleared off all the wrong exits. Now, the unbeliever does not have that guarantee. For the unbeliever, what appears to be obvious may be correct, but it may not be. There may be hidden reefs. There may be dangers in that route. And again, as opposed to us, if God has carved out a path of the obvious for us, there aren't any landmines there. For the unbeliever, it may be hidden dangers, and that's exactly what happened here. So they're tacking along, and they're thinking, so far, so good, and then disaster. The worst possible thing that could happen to a ship on the sea in the treacherous sailing season is for a hurricane to hit, and that's what hit. A Euroquillo. They call them today Euroclidons, but they still have them. They zoom down quickly. They strike from the northeast of all places. So normally you have the prevailing wind west to east in the Mediterranean. Now you have this nor'easter, this northeast hurricane coming down over 100 miles an hour. And remember, hurricane force wind is 74. So now the ship is blown hopelessly to the southwest. And now it's impossible to stop. As they're now being carried along towards the southwest, all of a sudden they realize where they're headed, and they go into horror because they're headed to the Syrtis Banks. Syrtis Banks were a disaster, a disastrous place to be. They were sand reefs, and not just sand, they were quicksand. Archaeologists have dug down at the Syrtis Banks, and they found a graveyard of ships there. And what a horrible way to die. First, the bow gets stuck in the quicksand. As the storm's beating on the ship and you can't move, so you're being battered. At the same time you're being battered, you're sinking into the sand. Just a nightmare. So now they're horrified because they know where they're going. Going southwest to the Syrtis Banks. Just off the coast of, they called it Cyrenaica then, we call it Libya now. So now, they're being plunged towards the Syrtis Banks, and all of a sudden they get some slight relief. They come to a very small island called Clauda. Very, very small. They don't have a harbor. And if you look at your map, if they come to a little island called Clauda, you see when they left Fair Havens, they didn't get very far, did they? When they started tacking along to the west trying to get to Phoenix, if they're now hitting Clauda, they didn't make it very far before the hurricane hit. So they don't have a place to stop, but at least they get a slight bit of relief from the winds. So they do four things in this slight little reprieve. They pull the lifeboat that has been trailing behind them, they pull it up on the boat. Two, they did what was called frapping. They would wrap cables underneath the ship to actually hold it together. Three, they would drop the anchors to slow the ship down a little bit from headed toward the Syrtis Banks. By the way, the anchors that they used were not like with hooks. They were just real big blocks of wood. Drop the anchor, slow it down. And four, they started jettisoning, throwing off things. You know why? Because water was coming in the boat. The boat is starting to sink. And they want to be as high as possible if they get close to those Syrtis Banks. Start throwing stuff off. And as we saw last week, what a picture this is. of how human beings cope with disasters and trouble in the world, or how human beings try to protect themselves from trouble, how to cope with this world. Undergird yourself. Develop more strength, more self-effort, more self-discipline to cope with the storms of life. Christians tend to fall into that same way of thinking, which is wrong. Undergird myself. Today I'm going to tell you what the remedy is. So now, they've done the best they can, but now they've lost the cover of Clouda, and now the winds pick up again from the northeast, blowing them towards the banks. And to make it worse, now it's dark, pitch dark. They can't see anything. You imagine? You know you're going to the Sardis banks, but you can't see anything. Verse 20 of chapter 27. Since neither sun nor stars appeared for many days. And let's pause here. It's hard for us to realize what it's like to live in a place where you only know where you are because of the sun and the stars. We have GPSs. We have all kinds of ways to know where we are. They didn't have anything. And they couldn't see the sun and the stars. They literally didn't know where in the world they were. And no small storm was assailing us. There's Luke. He loves to use, remember that figure of speech? It's called a litotes. And it's a denial of the negative. Whenever Luke uses no small something, he means a real big one. From then on, all hope of our being saved was gradually abandoned. It's interesting, the word saved is a word that means saved in the sense of rescued from difficulties in life, and it means in the sense of our eternal salvation. It's the same word. So we obviously have an allegory here. But what a grim picture this is of human life in the fallen world. All hope of our being saved was abandoned. That's typical. That's typical human life in the fallen world.
Is there another saved word that could be used in that sentence, but that other word was used purposely for that? Or
yeah, you're asking, is it always the case that the word saved has the dual meaning? The answer is no. There are many words that mean rescued, delivered in a secular type sense from a given situation. This is the word soterios. We talk about soteriology as the theological term for the doctrine of salvation. That's the word used here. Dr. Luke would have put the word there on purpose to give us the ambiguity. But Luke is also painting a picture of what life is in the world without God. People try to do what's right. I'm talking about moral unbelievers. I'm not talking about the riffraff of the world. I'm talking about good, moral people. Try to do what's right. They try to do what's best. They exercise self-discipline. All of us know unbelievers who are like this, don't we? Good people. They do things right as best they can. They put as much self-effort in as they can. Where's that going to end up? They're going to be doomed because self-effort won't get it. Ephesians 2:12, Paul describes the unbeliever as having no hope and without God in the world. That's where self-effort leads, right there. And see, unbelievers, they do their best to cope with this world, hope to get out of here alive. It's going to end up in darkness and drifting, aimless and without hope. Unfortunately, the vast majority of people continue that way. Or they don't even accept the fact that their situation is hopeless. They don't know it, but they're drifting along toward the Sardis banks. And they don't even know it. They're dark. When people realize it's hopeless, when people realize, one, I can't cope with this world. I may do for a while, but when big things come, I can't deal with it. And above all, when people realize there's nothing I can do to get out of this world alive. I'm utterly hopeless. That's exactly where God wants them. And that's exactly where God wanted these sailors. He wanted them hopeless. He didn't want them to have some hope. You see, if they had kept sailing along, kept coming under islands, and barely made it to Rome, they would have never caught on that there were hope. They would have thought, see, I did it. I did it my way. God let them get to that situation of hopelessness and darkness so they would see, I can't cope and I can't get out of here alive. When people are like that, they're ready for the gospel. And now the people in this story, they hadn't been listening to Paul. Now they're ready to listen to Paul. Verse 21, when they had gone a long time without food, then Paul stood up and said, "Men, you ought to have followed my advice and not to have set sail from Crete and incurred this damage and loss." I love Paul. In the middle of the most difficult circumstances, life-threatening circumstances, Paul is still perfectly capable of saying, "Told you so, I told you so." I admire him. Actually, you know, that was Paul's personality. What's amazing is God used that, because Paul was just saying, "Told you so." God was using it to establish credibility. Like, what I said back then came out to be right. Now listen to me. Verse 22, "Now I urge you, keep up your courage, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship." Now, he wasn't guessing. He got a direct revelation. "For this very night, an angel of the Lord, to whom I belong and whom I worship," it doesn't say serve, probably wasn't doing much serving for God there on that boat, "whom I worship stood before me." Notice those two things. I'm going to develop those in a minute. It's very important. What I want to point out is the context of getting and understanding a spiritual revelation is tied to the fact that Paul said, "I belong to him, I belong to God, and I worship him." Well, this angel said, "Don't be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar. And behold, God has granted you all those who are sailing with you." Angel's reminding him, God's will is not going to be thwarted. You're going to go to Rome. You're going to see Emperor Nero. And what a great benefit for everybody with Paul. Paul's going to make it, so everybody who's with Paul has a side guarantee they're going to make it too. And what a picture that is. Even though believers are, I believe, drastically outnumbered in the world, our presence here creates benefits. You know one thing that just our presence does? It restrains evil. That's right. Just our presence in the world restrains evil. Why? Because our bodies are where Holy Spirit lives. Holy Spirit restrains evil. I think even Christians have a wrong idea about Holy Spirit. I think we all have many wrong ideas about Holy Spirit. He's not some force emanating around the world. He's not like some cloud hovers around the world. Holy Spirit is not out there like some vapor. God's Holy Spirit lives within the bodies of believers. So, it's really a matter of simple math. Holy Spirit restrains evil. Holy Spirit lives within us. Therefore, our presence creates a benefit for everyone around us. And that's why when we leave at the rapture, before the great tribulation, we take with us the indwelling power of Holy Spirit out of the earth, and that's when Antichrist comes in to fill the void. Now, Holy Spirit will not stop ministering to the world during the great tribulation. He will just do it somewhat externally as he did in the Old Testament. See if I can work my way back to Acts 27.
There's a boat in the Mediterranean.
Boat in the Mediterranean. I knew you'd be right on top of it. Paul says, "Listen, you guys need to stick with me. I'm guaranteed to get to Rome. Therefore, keep up your courage, men, for I believe God that it will turn out exactly as I have been told. But we must run aground on a certain island." I'm going to pause here because I think this is very important. Paul got direct supernatural revelation from God. And I think we have to identify two factors here. When we're speaking about supernatural, spiritual revelation, we have to make a very clear distinction between what God granted and what Paul received. I think Christians tend to get cloudy and murky about that. What God grants as opposed to what we receive. 1 first, let's look at what God granted. What did God grant Paul? He granted him a specific, direct, supernatural revelation. And you see the reason why? The reason is, he says, he is the God to whom I belong. He's saying, I am God's property. I belong to him. So he's saying, since I am God's property, he is responsible for what happens to me and not myself. And you see, that's how Paul could rest. We talk about rest. We've talked about it many times here. It does not mean you don't do anything. Rest means you rest from anxiety. And a powerful way to rest from anxiety is to do what's obvious, do what's set before us, but don't do so with the false thinking that the outcome is our responsibility. There's no telling how many burdens we carry in our lives thinking that I'm responsible for what happens. Think about it. Can we control what happens? We can barely control ourselves. Can't control what anybody else is doing. Can't control the weather. We do what's obvious. God says, I'm responsible for you. You're my property. So we do what's obvious. We do what's set before us. But we don't think we're responsible for the outcome. So that's why God granted that revelation to Paul. And there's no other reason. And that's why God grants revelation to us. Because we're his property. He bought us. You know where that deal was consummated? At the cross. When the Bible says we were redeemed, he provided our redemption, that's what it's referring to. He bought us, and we became his property. And so the only requirement for God granting special revelation is that you be one of his. By believing in his Son Jesus' work on the cross as your substitute. So part one, God grants direct revelation to everyone of his children, everyone who he has bought at the cross. But there's a second half, and that is that Paul heard that revelation. And I think many Christians get in this rut of God's granting us revelation, but we're not hearing it. See, there are no preconditions for God giving us revelation if we're a believer. You don't have to pray. You don't have to fast. You don't have to give up certain things. You don't have to go through religious rituals. Don't keep repenting and confessing. If you're his, he's giving you revelation. James chapter 1 says that God gives wisdom to everybody, everywhere, without conditions. The problem is we don't hear it. And here's how Paul heard it. Paul heard it because he said, I worship him. I want to clarify this. It does not mean you walk around singing hymns and you'll hear God. Doesn't mean that. The word worship is actually a word that's sort of rare in the New Testament. It was frequent in the Old Testament because it referred to worshiping in the temple. It referred to what happened within the temple, specifically to the offerings. So when the priest would offer up the burnt offerings, the grain offerings, the trespass offerings, the sin offerings, all of those offerings were a picture of somebody, Jesus. He's the burnt offering. He gave everything. He's the burnt, the peace, the grain, the trespass. So whenever the priest would put the sacrifice up on the altar and it's burned up, that's a picture of lifting up Jesus to heaven. And those sacrifices, remember, were a substitute for the person. So to put all this together, the act of worship in the Old Testament meant holding up the sacrifice, lifting it up to God and saying, don't look at me, look at him. And that's how we worship God. Do you realize that? Now, does it mean singing? Oh, it may take that form. Praising? It may take that form. But it may not. I doubt if Paul was singing and praising on the deck of this ship. But you know what he kept doing? He kept telling God the Father, don't look at me, look at him. Hold Jesus up. Remember, he's not our example. He's our substitute. So worship means holding him up, lifting him up, not ourselves. Lifting Jesus up is worship. we do that, we'll hear him. And you know why? It's not because God says, well, if you don't lift Jesus up, I'm not going to let you hear. No. There's a simple reason why we only hear what God is telling us through Jesus. And that is because he's our channel. Remember, he's us. He's our substitute. We live our lives saying, don't look at me, look at him. He's my substitute. Anything, God, you deserve to punish me for, he's my substitute. He already did it. Anything you require of me, I can't do it, he's my substitute. If we have that attitude, we're dialed in. We're dialed into him, and those revelations that he's been granting are what we hear. And that's exactly the way it was with Paul. And that's why he specifies those two things. I belong to him, and I lift him up. Therefore, he heard. So he says, we'll all make it safely to shore, but the boat will be lost. What a picture that is. It's a picture of Romans 8:30. And these he predestined, he called. And those he called, he justified. And those he justified, he glorified. Wish I had time to go through all of those. He's saying, everybody who God predestined to be saved will be glorified in heaven. Everybody who God predestined will make it safely to shore. Now, Calvinists would say that people who are saved because God pre-elected people who would be saved. Arminians would say God looked down the corridors of time and saw the people who would believe and elected them. However you want to look at it, everybody who's saved will make it through to the shore safely. And Paul says, not one will be lost. That's the picture here. It amazes me how Christians can think they can lose their salvation. They have taken a few verses which they've twisted violently out of context. It amazes me how people will base doctrines on vague verses and utterly, totally ignore clear passages. I would like for someone who believes you can lose your salvation to tell me where in that chain they're possibly lost. Because he's saying everybody who is predestined is already glorified. So where along can somebody fall out? And the answer is they can't. Everybody who's saved makes it through. And he says this though, but only the ship will be lost. You know what that means? That means this, that in general, bodies die. Ships shipwreck and bodies die. And believers are mortals like everybody else. So the normal course is believers' bodies die. But then we just survive that death. Our bodies are reassembled and our spirit and soul reunite. But I want to repeat a very important asterisk I said last week. And that is that not every believer will die. There's a final generation of Christians who will not taste death. This ship won't be wrecked. I'm ready for some improvements on the ship, but I really don't want it wrecked. It's like the great philosopher and theologian Woody Allen said, I'm not afraid of dying, I just don't want to be there when it happens. And you know what he meant.
Everybody wants to go to heaven, just not now.
Yes. Yes. Unless it's the liftoff. And that's in 1 Thessalonians 4:15-17. This I say to you by the word of the Lord. There we go again. He got a direct revelation. Why? Because he belonged to God. It's why God gave it to him. Why did he hear it? Because he lifted Jesus up. Here's what he got. We who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. These are our loved ones who have gone before us. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with archangel voice, and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds. And here's that word, as I mentioned before. Whenever people say the word rapture is not in the Bible, it drives me crazy. Tim LaHaye, who believes in a pre-tribulation rapture, he believes everything I think pretty much exactly right about the end times. Tim Hay says some things that are bad. Tim Hay said, well, I concede the word rapture is not in the Bible. I want to say, Tim.
Give me a break.
Give me a break, yes. The word caught up, let me say it for you in Greek, raptazo. Did you catch that? Raptazo. So, is the word rapture? Well, not technically, but the word raptured certainly is. We'll be raptured in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we'll always be with the Lord. Our loved ones who have gone before us, maybe we buried them, maybe we cremated them. Either way, God will restore all those atoms. And you know what I love about our reunion with our loved ones? It won't be in heaven. You know where it'll be? It'll be right here on earth. They'll be raised first. Our reunion will be right here on earth. And then, how do I know? He says, because we'll be caught up together with them. The point is that, in general, bodies of believers for 2,000 years have died, but they're still alive. The picture is that ship may wreck, but the person will make it on. And by the way, this rapture is going to happen soon. I'm more and more convinced. What is amazing to me is a lot of the things that are scaring Christians are encouraging me. When I see what appears to be a breakdown between Israel and the United States, it doesn't scare me. That had to happen, according to prophecy. Absolutely had to happen. People, Christians, are afraid of Vladimir Putin. I'm not. Vladimir Putin went down to Iran. I knew he would. The Bible said he would. Yeah, Gog Magog. It was predicted they would go to Iran and work out a deal. You know what else the Bible says? Putin is double-crossing him. What a thought. Russia double-crossing somebody? Communist? Vladimir Putin. And I tell you something else. Read Ezekiel 38 sometime. I believe God's about to put some hooks in Mr. Putin's mouth and drag him where he doesn't want to go. So all the things that are scaring Christians are a great encouragement to me. We're about to lift off. Back to our story here. They're still drifting along like I have been. Now, everything's going great, except for a few little issues. They're headed toward the quicksand, certain death. They can't control the ship, and they can't see where they are. Other than that, it's great. Verse 27, but when the 14th night came, you know what that means? 2 weeks since the hurricane. They've been out there being blown around for 2 weeks. We're being driven around the Adriatic Sea. Adriatic Sea then was larger than it is now. Now the Adriatic Sea is up there between Italy and Greece. In these times, the Adriatic Sea was considered to extend down almost to Cyrenaica there, to Libya. But about midnight, the sailors began to surmise. It's translated, they were approaching some land. I just happen to love the way it literally reads. They began to surmise that some land was approaching them. Did you know why I love that? That's how sailors think. I was reading excerpts from the Odyssey this week, and I noticed they were coming to the island of Crete, and the sailor said, we raised up Crete. Or we raised up these mountains. So from their perspective, they're causing these things to raise up. Now they knew that wasn't really happening. That's just the way they talk. Now, they began to surmise that some land was approaching them. Something about sailors, they know when land is near. And the thinking is they smell it. And they can smell it from a long way away. So they started taking soundings. They had a long piece of rope with a little scoop on the bottom. And they dropped the rope until it stopped, pull it up, and if they found sand, they knew where the bottom was. So they did the first sounding, is 20 fathoms. Fathoms about 6 feet, so about 120 feet. And a little further on, they took another sounding and found it to be 15 fathoms. Now they got like 90 feet. They're getting close to land. Oh, this is good news. This is great news. But remember Murphy's Law? If everything seems to be going well, you have obviously overlooked something. Well, they had. Here's what they'd overlooked. It's great news to be close to land. It's bad news to be close to land when it's dark. Now they realize, ruh-roh, it's not good that we're close to land. So now verse 29, fearing that we might run aground somewhere on the rocks, they cast four anchors from the stern and prayed for daybreak. It's translated wished for daybreak. They're beyond wishing. They're beyond wishing and hoping. They're praying. Why'd they cast the four anchors? Slow it down at least. They don't want to crash into that island. But what a picture this is of the world, isn't it? They're taking those soundings for their security. You know what the picture is? Human beings want to find security by the connection with this earth. That's where human beings find security, self-esteem, self-worth, by connecting to this world. So they're at ease when they detect the ground. Aha, I feel better now. See, their security, their anchor for life are circumstances in this world. You know, this world is a bad place to anchor. It's a terrible place to anchor. Well, these people now, their security is established on how well they're connected to the earth, but here's Murphy's Law again. If you have four things you've taken care of, a fifth thing you never even thought about will happen. Yes, now we have another issue. Verse 30. As the sailors were trying to escape from the ship and had let the ship's boat into the sea on the pretense of intending to lay out anchors from the prow. They're saying, we forgot about a couple of anchors up here in the prow. You know what the prow is? It's the top of the bow. We forgot about those anchors. Well, that's where the lifeboat was. They're intending to get in that lifeboat, but they're thinking the big ship will crash on the land, but not this little one. Unfortunately, there's not enough room for everybody. So Paul, who one of his spiritual gifts was singing, being a tattletale, Paul saw it. So Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men remain in the ship, you yourselves can't be saved. And I love this picture too. It almost seems like a contradiction, doesn't it? Remember, he has said, God assured me, I'm going to Caesar, everybody's going to make it, and everybody's going to make it safely to that island. But then he says, if these guys leave, you can't be saved. You see the contradiction? It's not a contradiction. It's a picture of two things that seem like a contradiction to us, and that is this. God has decreed everybody's going to be saved. It's his choice. He's sovereign. He's not just sovereign over salvation. He's sovereign over everything. So why wouldn't he be sovereign over salvation? However, every person in this life has to make the choice to trust in Jesus as Savior or reject. That's the picture here. So they catch the guys, and look what they did. Verse 32. Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the ship's boat and let it fall away. Isn't that funny? They didn't just pull the boat back in and tie it up and say, well, you can't use the boat, obviously. They threw the boat into the sea. Temptation is quickly gone, isn't it? And, like, we're all in this together. Reminds me of Cortez. He lands at Veracruz. The Indians are more threatening than what they thought. Some of Cortez's men are going to mutiny and leave. Remember what Cortez did? He burned all the ships. None of us are going back. Cut off any source. Cut off any activity except staying here. And here's another picture we have. You see, it's a picture of the fallen world again. People trying to cope. People trying to get out alive through self-effort, self-reliance. Even through a little plan here. Use that little boat. Picture is, cut off anything you're clinging to. To cope in this world or to get out alive except Jesus. Just cut off the ropes. Acts 4:12. There is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. So you see, if someone's relying on self, good works, being a good person, being a religious person, cut it off. And there's a message for us as Christians too. And the message is, if we're trying to cope with things in this world through self-discipline, through undergirding ourselves, cut it off. Just cut it off. Or, you know what Christians tend to do? Jesus plus. Jesus plus baptism. Jesus plus religious rituals. Jesus plus make Him Lord of my life. Jesus plus self-discipline. Cut all that off except Jesus. Let it drop into the water.
Johnny, when this voyage started, how many believers were there?
3.
How many do you think there are now?
Well over 200, I believe. I don't want to rush through the rest of this. There's too much here. I could skim over it, but there are several great pictures that remain here. I would like to close with just one thought. All those efforts that the sailors made, and by the way, they were good efforts. They were the right thing to do. Dropping the anchors, undergirding the ship. Those were all good things to do. Obvious things to do. From the nautical perspective. But when we see pictures of life, it's a picture of people trying to get their security from things in the world or from self-effort. That anchor won't work. And we Christians tend to fall into the same rut. We just Christianize it. We take self-help books and add prayer to them. You know, Christian writers today are big on writing a self-help book and sprinkling it with all kind of religious words. It's all self-help. That's a bad anchor. Our anchor is not in the sea of this world. It's in heaven. Hebrews 6:19. Paul is speaking about faith in Jesus Christ alone to cope with this world, to get out alive. And he says, this certainty, it's not a hope. This certainty we have as an anchor of the soul. Jesus is our anchor. A certainty both sure and steadfast. Sure means we have 100% connection. Steadfast means we're connected 100% of the time. And one which enters within the veil. What is the veil? The veil is part of the temple in heaven. There is a veil surrounding the throne of God where God, our Father, lives. And that's the center of the universe. That's the headquarters. That's the base of operation for everything in the whole universe. Now, wouldn't that be a great place to have an anchor? Not tied to anything in this world. Our anchor's tied to the control room of heaven. Next week, we will get Paul to that island and on to Rome. Father, we thank You again for this passage, and we thank You for the contrast we see between the life of coping with circumstances of this world and our own strength and self-effort, which is hopeless. But we also realize that our anchor is not tied to anything in this world. It's tied to You in heaven. So, Father, You give us the wisdom to know what things we should cut off from our lives. Anything beyond Jesus. Anything where I believe that I am responsible for the outcome. Remembering that He is not our example. He's our substitute, and we thank You in Jesus' name this morning. Amen.
Let's keep on looking for the light. Oh, can't you see the morning after? It's waiting right outside the storm. Why don't we cross the bridge together and find the place that's safe and warm? Not too late, we should be giving. Only with love can we climb. It's not too late, not while we're living. Let's put our hands up. your morning.